Blackadder is, in my opinion, one of the greatest sitcoms ever made, so it came as something of a shock to discover nobody has ever bothered to make an even slightly in-depth retrospective of the show on YouTube. So I had a cunning plan, and here are the results of that.
Harry? Who is that?
It is your other son, my lord.
The show consists of four series of six episodes each, plus several one-off specials that revolve around Edmund Blackadder and its dog's body, Baldric, as protagonists, set in different time periods in British history. The first series is set in the Middle Ages and came about as Rowan Atkinson and Richard Curtis, who had met at Oxford University in 1979, before going on to work together on Not the 9 O'Clock News, had developed the idea for a sitcom whilst working on that show. Curtis was inspired by Fawlty Towers and originally tried to create a detective-based sitcom, but he couldn't make that work, so not wanting to be compared to Fawlty Towers, they decided to make the show a historical one rather than setting it in modern times. An unaired pilot was produced, which has never been aired on TV, nor been made available on DVD or home video, so I have never seen it personally, even though some bootleg copies do exist allegedly. The pilot had a few key casting differences from the commissioned series, one in particular being hugely important, with Baldric being played by comedian Philip Fox, who has appeared in numerous TV shows and Radio 4 productions in the UK before and since. Having never seen the pilot, I can't comment on his performance, but I just can't imagine anyone but Tony Robinson as Baldric. Robinson, who was nearly 40 at the time, had been a bit part actor up to this, his big break, and has gone on to achieve fame beyond Blackadder as the host and creator of shows I love, namely Time Team, an archaeological digging show that ran for 2 decades, and Maid Marian and Her Band of Merry Men, that was another semi-historical comedy on the BBC aimed at kids from 1989 to 1994. Rowan Atkinson, a man who will need no introduction, as he's one of the world's most recognisable comedy actors after his portrayal of Mr. Bean and Johnny English, co-wrote the first season with Curtis and played the titular character anti-hero Prince Edmund Blackadder. The main cast is rounded out by Tim McInerney in his first role on TV, playing Blackadder's bumbling idiot friend Lord Percy Percy. McInerney has gone on to have a long and varied career in TV, film, radio and theatre. The Blackadder, which was the name given to the first series, had a considerable budget, costing around £1 million for 6 half-hour episodes, which was a huge sum of money for a British TV show in 1983, never mind a sitcom. A considerable amount of location shooting took place, especially at Alnwick Castle in Northumberland, which is Hogwarts in the Harry Potter franchise, plus the backdrop of a whole bunch of other Hollywood productions. They also used a huge cast of extras, guest stars and expensive medieval-style costumes. So, it will come as no surprise to anyone when I say The Blackadder is by far the worst series of the show.
Or, as I shall be known from now on, The Black Vegetable.
Now, I was far too young to watch Blackadder on TV as a child when it first aired, so I actually watched the series in a bit of a strange order. I came across a video box set of Blackadder 2 in a bargain bin at Woolies and begged me dad to buy me it because I was obsessed with history and still am in many ways. After a bit of saying no, seeing as it was a 15 age restriction and I was about 9, I finally got my hands on the video and instantly fell in love with the show and the characters. I then watched Blackadder Goes Forth, and only then did I get to The Blackadder. So in my mind, I had it very firmly implanted that Blackadder was the suave, cunning one, and Baldric was the idiot. Which brings me to the very first episode of Blackadder to air on the 15th of June 1983, The Foretelling.
Oh, Edmund. It's the lying I find so hurtful.
The first thing you are going to notice is the characters' personalities are the wrong way round. Prince Edmund is a snivelling idiot, and Baldric is actually quite intelligent and the one who has sensible plans. It just doesn't quite work as well as the opposite way around, especially if you came to The Blackadder from series 2 and 4, which are arguably the best ones. Now, I hate it when someone recommends me a show and says, trust me, this show is great, but except for seasons 1 and 2, which suck, but trust me, it gets better in season 3. Blackadder isn't that. Thankfully, it's good in series 1, just not great. And then series 2 is some of the best comedy ever made. Now I've got all that out of the way, let's review The Foretelling. The year is 1485 and we start with a prologue outlining the worst villains and liars in history, including Henry VII, who rewrote history to suit his own needs, which is essentially the setup for the Blackadder's premise, with the hunchbacked and evil Richard III being shown to be a kind, loving uncle whose nephews grew up, one of whom became Richard, Duke of York, played by Brian Blessed. Now I am biased. As I've said before on this channel, Brian Blessed is an absolute national treasure, and everything he is in is elevated by his mere presence, and this is no different. His over-the-top exuberance and booming voice is absolutely perfect for the part of the soon-to-be Richard IV. After a brief introduction to the main characters at a feast on the eve of the Battle of Bosworth, including Richard III, who is the comic giant that is Peter Cook, a man who essentially invented the satirical comedy scene in Britain in the 1960s, he lends an air of comedic legitimacy to the proceedings, and he's pretty great as Richard here, being the deadpan setup to Rowan Atkinson's rubber-faced silliness. Of course, Edmund sleeps in and misses the start of the battle, with his mother, who is Elspeth Grey, waking him up. Richard III, in this alternate true history, wins the Battle of Bosworth, but not before Edmund cuts his head off for trying to steal his horse, resulting in his father becoming Richard IV, and Percy, the absolute idiot, bringing Henry Tudor back to the castle. Tim McInerney is frankly perfectly cast as Lord Percy, and I think even in this first episode it's kind of obvious why Blackadder doesn't work, with him being an idiot and Baldric the clever one, because he and Percy are just too similar in character. Even though McInerney and Atkinson give great comedic performances, a lot of the jokes land a little flat due to them being mirror images of each other, so jokes have nothing to bounce off. For a brief moment, Edmund considers calling himself the Black Vegetable, before Baldric suggests he name himself the Blackadder. Then he gets haunted by Richard III, leading to the funniest sequence involving Edmund and his mother thinking he's having sexual relations with a sheep. In fact, I think Elspeth Grey gets all the biggest laughs from me in this first episode. Her deadpan delivery and the character's general confusion just works comedically against Edmund's more wacky tone and Brian Blessed's over-the-top delivery. Once Henry Tudor has escaped, Edmund chases after him, only to bump into three witches who tell him he will be king. This actually, unusually for Blackadder, sets up a somewhat series narrative arc. Post-credits, we get another scene where the witches realise they told the wrong person. They meant to tell Henry Tudor and not Edmund. Episode 1 is a decent start to the series. It sets up the characters and the general tone it's going for. There are a number of laughs, and the storytelling is exceptionally grandiose for a British comedy of the era. All the characters have period dress, and they look magnificent, as do all the sets, seeing as this was shot on location, which really does set it apart from most shows of the period, which had sets that looked like they were made entirely from cardboard. Mainly because they were. This episode is obviously also a strong satire of Shakespeare and his plays Richard III, Henry V, Hamlet and Macbeth. Peter Cook apparently hated scripts, so just improvised a lot of his lines, including the speeches that are comedic reimaginings of some of Shakespeare's most famous soliloquies. This use of Shakespearean narrative is a recurring theme throughout the first series, with almost every episode actually having some element of it. The one problem with this opening episode is that Edmund feels wrong. As I previously said, he works far better as a character when he's the suave, intelligent one that bounces jokes off the two idiots Percy and Baldric. Ironically, he was that way in the pilot episode, but for reasons beyond me and seemingly anyone else, they decided to switch it for the commissioned series. All in all, episode 1 isn't a bad start to the show, with some genuine laughs, but if you enjoy this, you'll enjoy the rest of it. If you don't, then series one is probably not for you.
Oh yes! The universe! Oh, I wish I owned one.
Oh, I wish I'd married one.
Born to be King was originally aired as episode two, but on later broadcasts and DVD releases, it has been switched with episode four, The Queen of Spain's Beard. I have chosen to review these in release order rather than DVD order. With that out of the way, episode 2 is thankfully a bit of a step up in the laughs department from episode 1, revolving around guest actor Alex Norton's character, the 4th Duke of Argyll. Norton will be recognisable to anyone who watched the long-running Scottish TV show Taggart, as he appeared on that amongst many other British shows for many years. Due to the fact Richard IV goes on crusade against the Turks in the pre-credit scene, we also get a chance to explore Robert East's character, Prince Harry, Edmund's older brother. East is actually an actor I'm not too familiar with, although he did appear in some of the most famous British comedies of the 70s, 80s and 90s, usually in bit parts as far as I can tell. Here he is left in charge whilst the king is away fighting the Turks, which gives Blackadder a chance at real power, or so he thinks, because in the end he is left looking after the royal sheep and privies. Oh, and he also has to organise the entertainment for St Leonard's Day, which just also happens to be the day his father will return. He's further annoyed when Argyll turns up and mistakes him for a eunuch, and asks for lands in Scotland that belong to Blackadder. It is at this point that we get the beginnings of Baldric's cunning plans, catchphrase, in this exchange between him and Blackadder.
A little more cunning.
I have a cunning plan.
Yes, perhaps, but I think I may have a more cunning one.
Well, mine's pretty cunning, my lord.
Initially, Blackadder plans to murder him by a play he has Argyll appear in, The Death of a Scotsman, an obviously hastily re-scripted Death of a Pharaoh, but soon changes his mind when Argyll intimates that Harry is in fact a bastard. Shock horror, however, when Blackadder does read the letters out in court, it turns out that he is in fact the bastard. His father returns midway through this happening and absolutely steals the entire episode with his entirely over-the-top exuberance at delivering these lines.
Blood! Death!
I will never tire of hearing Brian Blessed speak. With the reveal of his illegitimacy, Edmund challenges Argyll to a duel, which he loses, and then in a pitiful display of cowardice, pleads for his life with Argyll showing him mercy. Of course, allowing Edmund to live was a mistake when Blackadder gives him a guided tour of the castle, including the insides of a cannon, which causes a very messy accident. This episode actually reuses a lot of the script of the unaired pilot, which differs in a few ways with Edmund organising the Queen's birthday and actors being different, including the King, Harry and Baldric. However, the narrative still revolves around Argyll revealing Blackadder's illegitimacy. As I said previously, this is a definite step up in terms of comedy value, with Blackadder having way more jokes land here than he did in the first episode, somewhat helped by the fact Robert East and Alex Norton are the perfect straight men foils to set up jokes for him to fall into.
Oh, and mind the weasel pit.
Literally, in this case. There is also the first appearance of a long-running staple of cunning plans, and a continuation of a joke of Edmund's father consistently throughout the series, forgetting who he is and what he's called. Series 1 has a lot of these running gags with virtually every character having their own. Elspeth Grey also once again gets one of the biggest laughs from me when she and one of her ladies-in-waiting are discussing life between the sheets. Her comic timing and deadpan delivery for the punchlines is always impeccable. However, the fact Blackadder is an entirely feeble twerp still doesn't work when he interacts with Percy. We even get a scene where Blackadder attempts to belittle Percy for being an idiot. The joke once again doesn't particularly land because he's also quite clearly a twerp. The fact he's a bit lacking between the ears also kind of ruins the cunning plan's repeated failures. The fact he's so incompetent and simple-minded makes the plan's failure certain. So the fact his incompetence makes it fail rather than others around him, like in the later series, is a less amusing somehow. Just two episodes into series one, and I think a bit of a pattern is emerging with Blackadder being overshadowed in the comedy stakes by the supporting cast, which would be fine, but he's in like 95% of the scenes and only about 50% of his jokes really land.
Yes, and the Archbishop of Canterbury is also a naughty little boy whose bottom I had to smack for relieving himself in default.
Episode 3, The Archbishop, is a microcosm of the uneven quality of Series 1. Starts out with some actual belly laughs, has long periods of nothing much to laugh at, and then the biggest laugh of the show so far. The plot is basically a comedic retelling of the murder of Thomas à Becket. We start with Richard IV having his third Archbishop of Canterbury murdered in a year, and him appointing Edmund as the new one, threatening him with murder if he crosses him. Edmund finding out he's going to be the new Archbishop is the first big laugh for me. Call me childish, but I will never not laugh at a comically sized codpiece, and here is no different. Edmund attempts to flee what he perceives to be certain death, but he's caught in the act and his brother Harry goes along with him to make sure he gets invested. After becoming the Archbishop, Baldric becoming a monk and Percy becoming a bishop, they have to rush to make sure the lands of a dying noble are signed over to the king. Which they do. This section from him finding out he's going to be the Archbishop up to and through him stopping the noble signing his lands over to the church is mainly a laugh-free zone for me. But the last third is particularly funny with Brian Blessed and Elspeth Grey once again stealing the show with their dinner scene. Elspeth really does have such great understated comic timing throughout this series, and this scene is a great example of that. We also get another King Richard repeated gag.
Chiswick! Fresh horse!
Almost always repeated at a time when horses aren't required. It's here we also set in motion the Thomas à Becket-esque plot with two drunk knights, fresh from the Crusades, overhearing Richard retelling the story to the Queen, misunderstand and set off to kill Edmund. The next scene is probably the funniest so far, where Baldric has been investigating how they can make some cash from this gig, and the trade in religious relics.
There's a bone from the finger of our Lord. Baldric, you stand amazed.
Ah, I thought they only came in boxes of 10.
I lose it every time Baldric replies, I only thought they came in packs of 10. And Percy's reaction to it, it's the funniest scene in the whole of Series 1 so far, and highlights the problem overall with it. It's a self-contained comedic sketch that works rather than being a part of a situation comedy that works as a whole. Which you can say about all the best parts of The Blackadder. It has some wonderfully amusing sketches, but falls a little bit flat as a situation comedy. Blackadder eventually gets out of being Archbishop and being murdered by dressing up as a nun and getting caught wrestling on the ground by the Mother Superior. The whole episode is obviously a send-up of the medieval Catholic Church, where whether the portrayal is an accurate one is entirely debatable, but it's certainly one that fits into British post-Reformation attitudes towards Catholicism. It's not the last time we will see the church get lampooned either, so if that offends you, Blackadder is definitely not for you. Quickly moving on to what I think is by far my favourite guest appearance in Series 1. It's Jim Broadbent in Episode 4's The Queen of Spain's Beard.
Non te detengas, mio serpiente!
Don't hold back, please, my little one.
This was, I think, probably my favourite episode of the first series when I was younger, as it has some great guest appearances in it, and a bunch of jokes that straddle that line between offensive and hilarious. Having rewatched it, I have to say I laughed a hell of a lot at all the same jokes, even as a 40-year-old. The plot revolves around satirizing the medieval preoccupation with marrying off royalty to acquire alliances. The year is 1492 and Europe is in disarray, with women being raped by up to 7 different nations' armies per week, according to the pre-credit narrator, and Richard IV's court is no different. The king needs an alliance with the Spanish, only one problem. His favoured son Harry is already betrothed to half of Europe, so he has to use his spare, Osmond. Edmund. This is where Jim Broadbent comes in and steals the show by being the Spanish Infanta's interpreter, Don Speak English, who somehow manages to mispronounce every word in the English language.
I have waited for this moment all of my life.
And it is fantastically funny every time he does it. Edmund is of course not impressed with the Infanta, as she is a walrus, in his own words. So he, along with Percy and Baldric, get to scheming how to get out of it. The Infanta, however, superbly portrayed by Miriam Margoyles, who would go on to become a repeat guest star in later seasons of Blackadder and its various specials, is incredibly infatuated with Edmund. She's also really sexually voracious. Almost all of the jokes in this episode revolve around Blackadder's ploys to get out of the marriage. At first he tries to pretend to be gay and dresses up in a flamboyant style, which sets up a running gag about the Earl of Doncaster. This of course fails miserably because the Infanta thinks he's dressed up as a Spanish man, in a sign of his affection for her. The scene where Percy, Baldric and Edmund come up with this scheme and act it out also highlights the growing confidence between the trio of actors as comedic performers together. Their timing and facial expressions, etc., are just far more cohesive, and therefore the jokes land much better as a group than they were in earlier episodes. Edmund's next strategy is to get married to someone else. Of course, Percy being a complete berk, he gets a woman who is already married. The actor Howard Lou Lewis, who plays the woman's husband, would actually go on to star with Tony Robinson for many years in Maid Marian and Her Merry Men. With that plan failing, the only hope is to get Baldric to sleep with the Infanta, in the belief that her not being a virgin will stop the wedding. Yep, that also fails, but not before I absolutely lose it in fits of laughter at Jim Broadbent translating the sexy time in the pitch black.
Edmundo, amor mio!
Oh, Edmund, my love!
With all failing, it looks like Edmund has to go through with the marriage and only a miracle can save him. Which is when the recurring character, the messenger boy, arrives and delivers a message that the wedding has to be called off due to geopolitical shenanigans. The messenger was played by David Nunn, who had a sporadic bit part acting career in the late 70s and throughout the 80s. I can't say I've ever seen him anywhere else but in Blackadder, however. He usually interrupts either the King or Edmund with a piece of news, usually being a nuisance by delivering the news confusingly before getting thrown out of a room throughout Series 1. After leaving acting, he worked as an ambulance driver before sadly passing away in 2012 at the young age of 49. The episode ends with Edmund having to marry a beautiful Hungarian princess, who turns out is 8 or thereabouts, with just enough time for one last joke before the credits, that being Edmund reading his new wife a bedtime story. Episode 4 is the first episode in Series 1 that feels like a real Blackadder episode, one where it revolves around a problem and Edmund and co have to come up with a plan to get out of the problem, but repeatedly fail due to various reasons, other people and Percy's incompetence being chief amongst them, which is a welcome change in my opinion.
Bring out your dead!
Episode 5, The Witchsmeller Pursuivant, is another of my favourites from this first series. Another religious satire episode, this time satirising the medieval beliefs in witches and superstition. The year is 1495 and Europe is experiencing an outbreak of the Black Death. King Richard is afflicted and so Prince Harry is left in charge of matters of state. The local villagers have invited the Witchsmeller Pursuivant to town to find the witches responsible for the plague. We get yet another fantastic guest star performance in this episode, with Frank Finlay giving a suitably sinister and over-the-top performance as the Witchsmeller. Of course, Edmund is instantly accused of being the chief witch, mainly due to a rigged test and placed on trial. Cue the cunning plans.
Wait a moment, my lord. I have a cunning plan that cannot fail.
This was actually the second time that cunning plans was uttered in the series, and according to Tony Robinson, he decided to add the word cunning to his scripted line as he realised that it could be a running gag. So this is where that staple of the series really solidified into being. Of course they all fail miserably, and Edmund, Percy and Baldric find themselves guilty of witchcraft and condemned to burn at the stake as witches. Just right as all looks lost, Edmund's wife and mother visit and gift him a doll, which rather dejectedly he accepts. Unbeknownst to him, his mother is in fact a witch, and the Witchsmeller is the one who sets on fire when the time comes. As I said previously, This has always been one of my favourite episodes from this first series, and I think it's pretty obvious to me now why. This episode, above all the others, showcases the show's budget with large-scale sets, extravagant costumes, makeup and effects all being used on location, which was at the time pretty much unheard of for British television. But more importantly, the show's formula that would go on to be used so brilliantly in later series is really starting to come together by episode 5. That being a problem of the week, which imperils Edmund and co, and them incompetently making cunning plans that fail hilariously, before a deus ex machina sets everything back to normal by the episode's end. This is actually the only episode in the first series to not use any references to Shakespeare, with every other episode borrowing at least some dialogue or reference. Edmund as a character is also beginning to be less dim-witted and feeble by this point, which sets him apart from the other characters in the show, which are also largely feeble idiots.
Sorry. Slip of the tongue.
Your money and your life.
Which sets us up nicely for the series finale, episode 6, The Black Seal. The last episode sees a whole lot of guest appearances and sees Edmund finally become king, even if it is for all of 10 seconds. The year is 1498 and King Richard is handing out honours, or in Edmund's case, taking them from him. This spurs Edmund to get rid of Baldric and Percy from his service and set out to find the 6 most evil men in the kingdom to help him overthrow the king. He sets off to find his 6 evil henchmen, but on the way he finds an old man who, once the group's formed, reveals himself to be none other than his arch nemesis from childhood and master of disguise, Philip of Burgundy, the most evil man in the world, who is our first guest actor I'm going to mention, as he was none other than Patrick Allen, who provided the voice for all of the opening monologues that introduced every episode throughout The Blackadder, a man largely known for his voice work rather than his acting due to his very distinctive voice, is a great choice for Philip exactly because of that deep authoritative tone he possesses. He of course locks Edmund in a dungeon, threatening him that he is going to be slowly killed by snails over the next 15 years, whilst Burgundy kills the royal family and claims the throne that was never rightfully his. Which brings us to our other major guest appearance, that of Mad Gerald, played by Mad Gerald according to the credit, who in reality is of course the late great comedic genius Rick Mayall, making his first of many guest appearances in Blackadder. Pretty much everything is improved by Rick Mayall's inclusion, and this episode is no different, with him playing a quite mad person called Gerald. Eventually, thanks to Gerald's second best friend, Mr. Key, made from his own teeth, Edmund escapes, assembles the gang of evil henchmen, and arrives at the castle just in time to thwart Burgundy. Except he's a twerp and actually talks his henchmen into turning on him and joining Burgundy, who has a dastardly plan for Blackadder involving his unmentionables and a grinder, amongst various other bits of him being chopped off and mutilated. Good luck, Percy and Baldric arrive just in time to stop the bad guys. Except they don't save Edmund from a groinal mincing, and Percy accidentally poisons the whole court, meaning just briefly before he too succumbs to poison wine, Prince Edmund is technically King of England. The last episode of Series 1 is probably the weakest comedically of the later episodes, but is still a pretty fun time. The guest appearances are once again superb, and the narrative is entertaining in of itself, being an obvious parody and inversion of Seven Samurai. It also highlights the strong connection with the alternative comedy scene of the 80s that the show had, with many guest appearances throughout the series being comedians on that circuit. With the show blending traditional sitcom, alternative comedy and grandiose medieval drama together, not always perfectly comfortably, but an attempt was made, and episode 6 really does encapsulate this. So concludes the first chapter of The Blackadder, a rather uneven and some might say disappointing start to what is in my opinion one of the greatest sitcoms ever created. It has its moments of comedic genius, with Blackadder, Percy and Baldric never quite fully gelling as a comedy trio, but rather relying more on its grandiose medieval setting and drama to provide entertainment at great cost to the BBC. Which is why we had to wait 3 years for the next installment. But never fear, because Series 2 is where Blackadder absolutely hits its stride and creates 6 of the most hilarious episodes of all time. My initial cunning plan was to make this one long video, then I realised pretty quickly that it could well be over 2 hours long, so I'm splitting this up into 5 parts, one each for the 4 main series and one for the specials, hopefully. It doesn't take me 3 years to get part 2 out. If you want to hurry me along and watch that and enjoy this, then like, comment and subscribe.